sleep in until 8:45, maybe even 9 o'clock, every single day, and not be late for school, not miss practice. Think of all the things that those benefits, all that experience would benefit for our seniors, for our students, for our teenagers, and how much better the world will be as a result of it. What's your favorite animal? There are a lot of good choices, but I think we need to sometimes take interesting animals, maybe underappreciated animals. For me, I like the pangolin. How cute is that little guy? Now, they've gotten a little bit of a bad rap because, you know, some cultures in Asia, particularly China, think that if you crush up the scales of pangolin and then eat them, it'll be a magical, mystical cure-all for so many things. But one, that doesn't necessarily really work. And two, when you eat unregulated and untreated meat or parts of animals, you might get sick and you might cause a global pandemic. Not that that's the pangolin's fault, they're just going about their own business. But what does that mean for us? So there's this first year teacher, her name's Jennifer, and she, you know, just graduated from teacher college, from teacher school. She's fresh out, fresh faced. She's got her certification. She is ready to go. She's going to be teaching, you know, fourth graders, and you know, she can't believe how lucky she is. So she gets in, comes in over the summer, decorates her room, is just really excited to help all of her students learn. Now it's really important to her that all of her students feel like they're valued and they can learn and they can have success and they can, you know, believe in themselves. That mindset is just so incredibly important to her. So, you know, first day of school comes around, Jennifer stands up in front of the class, and she's looking out at, you know, all these kids. She just, her heart fills up with joy, and she needs them to know that they can all believe in themselves. And she says, you know, all right, you know, I want you all to believe in yourselves, and I believe that you are all intelligent, and you're bright, and you've got this great capability to learn, but, you know, if you think you're stupid, you know, I want you to stand up so we can help through it. And she looks out at her class, and nobody's standing up, and she feels good, until Johnny stands up. She looks out and she says, Johnny, do you believe that you're stupid? And Johnny says, no, ma'am, but you are the only one standing up, and I didn't want you to feel alone like you were stupid. Sometimes it's good to tell a joke to break the ice, to get yourself going. But you want to make sure that that joke is going to be, you know, fairly safe and accessible for people. Sometimes it takes some work to bring light into the world. Sometimes you burn yourself and it hurts a little bit. It's so much easier to take that light away, to snuff it out. But it's worth the light, it's worth the pain, it's worth the effort to make the world a little bit better. A drop of water. Might be still, might be peaceful, might have just fallen into a bigger thing of water. Maybe a lake, maybe a pond. But this picture is about more than water. This picture, this drop, or two drops, is about perfection. And it's about the importance of timing. Because this picture is taken exactly when one drop of water had splashed down and then begun to have a little bit of backsplash, and then the second drop hits it right at the exact same time. And it creates that incredible effect that you see right there. But this picture doesn't happen unless it's done at the exact right time. And timeliness matters. Bang! It's a powerful sound. St. Clair, Michigan, just a little bit after that. Well, right after that, but that was in sixth grade. And when I was in Marysville, so all the way through fifth grade, so it's about 11, 12, we'd have to run the mile for gym class. And I don't know if everyone still has to do that, but I remember going out to the football field and running, you know, 4 or 5 laps around the playground, and according to our gym teacher, that was a mile. And there was one kid, Josh Neal, and he won every single time. He wasn't necessarily like the fastest kid when we, you know, would play football or basketball. That was another kid, Nick. But Josh, man, he could just run forever. And he loved it. I remember him talking about how he'd go and he'd run with his dad. They did the crim, I think, and the turkey trot. And, you know, Josh and his dad, and they went and they ran. So he's a great distance runner. And, you know, fast forward a little bit, and, you know, Josh still loves to run, at least from what I'm told. In high school, he was on the cross country team, and he was, you know, like freshman all state. He just had an incredible year as a freshman. And, you know, everyone thought, man, Josh is really gonna just be a stud runner for the rest of high school. And all my friends in the cross country team were like, man, you know, hope we're able to beat him, and, you know, track season's gonna be really tough. He's worked so hard, and he's really talented at it. Josh never, he stopped running, but he didn't really stop running, because as a freshman, sometime in the spring, I want to say it was like April, Josh couldn't stop running. He, according to the stories, you know, he ran out of the cafeteria one day, and his friends couldn't catch him, and he ran off school grounds, and his friends tried to follow him, but Josh was an incredible runner, and his friends couldn't keep up. And Josh ran all the way to his house, and he ran all the way up the stairs, and his family, you know, wasn't there to catch him, and his friends were still too far behind. And then he ran to the closet, and bang, that's where his parents kept their shotgun. And that was the last time Josh ran anywhere. So, like many of you, I was in high school at one point, and it's been a little while, but, you know, I was 17, 18, 16, and went to high school, just like so many people have. And, like most teenagers, or many teenagers, most is maybe a little bit much, you know, romance was important. Romeo and Juliet about teenagers, very, very significant thing. And, you know, when it comes to high school, I did all right. I had a couple girlfriends, one of them almost like 2 whole months. So that was pretty good, I think. Things happen pretty quick when you're young. And specifically, having a boyfriend or a girlfriend or having a date, you know, is important when you've got kind of like the formal dances. There are times when you're kind of expected to have a date, or at least it seems like it. So my school, we had kind of 3 big dances. We had homecoming, pretty much most people get. We had prom, which most people get. And then Winterfest, which was kind of the sillier of the big dances. And then we would occasionally have small dances as well. So first couple years, so freshman year, sophomore year, you know, went to homecoming, mostly with a bunch of friends. You know, had a great time. I remember going to my buddy Andy's afterwards and, you know, playing Mario Kart. Just having a great time dancing with our friends and enjoying being together and being young. Sophomore year, kind of more of the same. You know, went with a group of people, had a great time, highly recommend it. By junior year, I'm thinking, you know, I'm gonna look back at high school and think I'd like to look back and say that, like, I had dates to these dances. And it takes the courage to, you know, get up and ask somebody to go. So, certainly, I got turned down at least once. That's not pleasant, don't recommend that. But, you know, it happens. Glad that I asked, and worth it for the experience. So let's go through how all my dance experiences went, and, you know, Brad's dating high school adventures. So 2000, junior, gonna go to homecoming, ask a girl who I'd kind of known for a long time, but was a couple years younger than me, she'll go to homecoming with me. She says yes, it's pretty good. I'm really excited. Turns out she has a tennis tournament the day of, so it's a Saturday. So, we get to where we're taking pictures at 5, then it's 5:30, then it's 5:45. I think she was about 50, 60 minutes late, which was stressful. Not her fault, you know, tournament just kind of went long. And that's when they got back and didn't want to rush anyone, but still kind of uncomfortable for me. And yeah, that's the high point. So it's all downhill from here. So prom junior year, asked a sophomore to go, and you know, she says yes. Don't necessarily know her as well, maybe as I know some other people, but thought, you know, we've talked online through text, and maybe it'll be a good time. So things seem like they're going well. We do pictures, we do dinner, everything seems good. And like 45, 50 minutes into the dance part of prom, she says, you know, I don't feel really good. She, you know, she'd been to the bathroom, come out a couple times. And I'm like, well, you know, that's really a bummer, but I'm gonna try to be a gentleman and, you know, like, hey, let me drive you home. And she's like, no, that's okay. One of my friends is gonna take me. And yeah, to this day, I don't know if that was just, man, I'm having such a bad time, I'm gonna fake being sick, or, you know, if she actually felt sick and that I just wasn't kind enough to make sure I got her home safely. So that wasn't great. So senior year, homecoming again, I ended up asking another girl who was, I think she was a sophomore at the time. She's definitely a sophomore at the time because the term sophomoric really comes to mind. So we're out to dinner with a, you know, group of friends, and you know, we've got drinks, they got like Coke and then whatever, you know, food it was. It's like a decent restaurant, not like crazy fancy, but like middle of the road. And so like partway through dinner, I remember she takes a bell pepper, so a green bell pepper, and just puts it in my Coke and starts laughing like that's the funniest thing ever. I'm just like, why is that funny? Because I don't really think that's particularly funny. And yeah, that kind of set the tone for the evening, and it was pretty awkward for a long time. You know, she apologized and we talked about it at the end, but still ended up being really weird. Very, very weird experience. So all right, I got one more shot. I got homecoming or prom as a senior. Gonna make this one count. You know, hanging out with my best friend, who, you know, maybe a little on again, off again, high school crush. So like my best friend who was a girl in high school, and right around February, I think, she's like, hey, you know, we should go to prom together. I'm like, yeah, this would be great. So we agree to go. It's gonna be good. But you know, time goes on, and so by the time prom rolls around, you know, Jen, who is awesome, you know, like she's got a boyfriend, and it wasn't me. And it's like, so, you know, I'm okay if you want to go to prom with, you know, your boyfriend. She's like, no, we'll still go together. And yeah, that sounds weird. It was, you know, we're still friends, but that was a weird experience. So there's a lot going on in high school. Why did you all do that? Please welcome to the stage Brad Baden, who's here to talk about turtles. Hi, I'm Brad Baden. I'm going to talk to you all about turtles. You are all wondering if you should foul when leading by two under 5 seconds left.